Okay, so with that, we'll move on to something known as contractive autoencoders. So this is yet another type of autoencoders, again with the same aim that you want to do some kind of a regularization. Okay, so it again tries to prevent an overcomplete autoencoder or even an undercomplete autoencoder for that point from learning the identity function, right? So it doesn't allow you to simply copy the inputs to the outputs. Okay, that's what it's trying to learn, and it does so by adding the following regularization term to the loss function. And the way it does this is by defining the following regularization term. Okay, what is this term? Okay, let's see some things which we already know. What is this? Frobenius norm of some matrix. What is this matrix? Jacobian. What is the Jacobian? Okay. What are the two variables here that you see? H and X. H is a scalar matrix vector, vector. X vector, right? So it is some function between two vectors, okay? And it's a matrix. So take a guess, how many entries would it have? If X is Rn and H is Rk, n cross k. Even if you don't know what the entries are, you are able to guess that it's going to be an n cross k matrix, right? Now let's see what this n cross k matrix looks like. Okay, so it has, the input has n dimensions and the hidden layer has k dimensions. So this is what the Jacobian looks like. What is the first column? It's the partial derivative of every neuron in the first hidden layer with respect to the first input, right? And now you can see what the other columns would be. This is what the Jacobian is. It's basically the derivative of H with respect to the vector X, and since this you're taking a derivative of a vector with respect to another vector, you will get a matrix as the output. Okay. Now, what does the J Lth entry here capture actually? What does the derivative capture? How much does HL change with a small change in XK? Right. That's what a derivative captures. Is that fine? And then what does the Frobenius norm capture? It's just the square of the sum of the square of all the elements of the matrix, right? So it's basically how much each of these elements vary with respect to the input, and you're just taking the square of that. So you see what is the term that we have added. Okay, now tell me, what is the intuition behind this? Okay, so when would this term, so remember, this term is added to the loss function and you're trying to minimize the loss function. So that means you want this term to go to, you want the Frobenius norm to be 0, right? Ideally. Of course, that will not happen because there's always a trade-off between L theta and omega theta. If you make it 0, then L theta would be very high, right? So now what would happen if one of these guys, say dou H1 by dou X1, actually goes to 0? What does that mean? H1 is not sensitive to variations in X1, right? Fine. But what was our original mandate? What did we want these neurons to capture? We wanted the neurons to capture these important characteristics, right? So if X1 changes, we want H1 to change. Do you get that? How many of you get that? We wanted the neurons to capture the important characteristics of the data, right? But now we have added a contradictory condition which says that we don't want the neuron to capture the variations in the data. Do you see this? So what is happening here? L theta says that I should be able to capture these variations, right? Otherwise, I'll not be able to reconstruct. If all my HIs are not sensitive to variations X1, that means I give it any X1, it will produce the same HI. Is that clear? Is that okay with everyone? Right? That means, so see, this is this, right? So I have these training examples. Across all these training examples, my bold X, which is the vector X, is going to change. That means XIs, which are the elements of this vectors, are going to change. Now, what this condition is saying is that if I change XI, I don't want the HLs to change. I don't want the values of the hidden representations to change. So that means it's saying that irrespective of what is the input fed to it, try to produce the same output. Do you get this argument? Okay. That means it's not capturing any important characteristics of the data. Is that fine? Is that a valid argument? But that's not what we wanted. We wanted it to capture the important characteristics of the data. So what are we trying to do? Okay, so just, it's hard for me to evaluate what you have said, but just pay attention and see if that is correct. You can judge it on your own, right? So that's the actually the idea, right? We have put these two contradictory conditions with each other, right? L theta says capture the important variations of the data. Omega theta says do not capture variations in the data. What's the trade-off? Capture only very important variations in the data. Do not capture the variations which are not important. Can you relate this to something that you have seen before? No, the other answer. There are only two answers, bias variance and PCA. When I say the other answer, what am I trying to force it to do? Capture only the important variations. It's okay if it's not clear right now. We'll come back to this, okay? So let us try to understand with this, with the help of an illustration, right? How many of you get the argument which I made on this slide? Okay, most of you get. Now this is the situation, okay? I have U1 and U2 as my dimensions, fine? Which of this is important? U1. The variations in the data across U1 is something that I should care about, because I can see that brings in some difference. What about the variations in U2? Not important. They seem like noise, right? Because these variations are there. They are not all lying on the central line. They are slightly away from the line. There are some variations. But should I go out of my way to capture these variations? Does it make sense to do that? No, right? So it makes sense to maximize a neuron to be sensitive to variations along U1. But it does not make sense to make the neuron sensitive to variations along this other dimension, which is U2. Okay? By doing so, we can balance the two conditions. So one condition was trying to capture all the important variations. Okay, do this. But do it only for the dimensions which really matter. The other condition says that don't capture important variations. Okay, do this. But do it only for those dimensions which do not matter. What does this remind you of? At least the diagram should give it away, right? It's same as principal component analysis. That's exactly what you try to do in PCA. You try to capture the variations across the important dimensions, but not across the non-important dimensions. How many of you get the concept of contractive autoencoders? Okay, good. So I think that's where we'll end lecture 7. And just a quick summary. So we showed that under certain conditions, autoencoders are equivalent to PCA. And we used this result very crucially there, that the SVD theorem, I'll not state it. And then we looked at different types of regularizations for autoencoders, where we looked at weight decaying, that means the standard L2 norm. We looked at the sparse autoencoder, the contractive autoencoder, and we also looked at these denoising autoencoders. Right? So that's the summary of this lecture.